Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Trinity Lutheran Church on this cold January morning. It's too much, isn't it? Sometimes the weather can really get to us. I understand. Last night my mom called me and said her furnace was dead, and this morning my own car wouldn't start. So I completely understand how that can happen. But on the other hand, my furnace is working, and my mom, well, she's going to be taken care of. The Lord is going to provide. And more, and also, best of all, God is taking care of you and me, not just with a car and with a furnace, but with forgiveness. To know that we can come to a warm church and praise God for all of our blessings, even if life doesn't always go the way we'd like. This morning is the third Sunday after the Epiphany, and we're also very pleased to welcome Pastor Don Duberstein. Pastor Duberstein is a member. He and his family are members here at Trinity, and he's actually the director of family here in our Wisconsin Synod. The headquarters is right up here in Waukesha, and we're very glad that he's going to be sharing God's word with us today. We're also very glad that our children are here this morning, and they're going to be singing at a little bit different point in the service. It'll be right after the prayer of the day. I'll announce it a little bit later to be more clear. We're going to be following the order of service that was handed to you. Will the congregation please stand? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Blessed Jesus, at your word, we are gathered all to hear you. Let our hearts and souls be stirred now to seek and love and fear you. By your teaching, sweet and holy, drawn from earth to love you solely.
Oh, how I love your law.
I meditate on it all day long.
Your commands make me wiser than my enemies,
for they are ever with me.
I have more insight than all my teachers,
for I meditate on your statutes.
How sweet are your words to my taste,
sweeter than honey to my mouth.
All our knowledge, sense, and sight lie in deepest darkness shrouded, till your Spirit breaks our night with the beams of truth unclouded. You alone to God can win us. You must work all good within us.
All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness,
so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work.
Yet so often we have despised God's word and failed to gladly hear and learn it. For this and all our sins, we bow before God and humbly ask his forgiveness. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray. Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner.
Gracious Savior, good and kind, light from God proceeding, open now our heart and mind, help us by your Spirit's pleading.
Hear the cry your people raises. Hear and bless your prayers and praises.
God gave his word so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. The scriptures testify about Jesus, who lived a perfect life for you, who died on the cross to pay for all your sins, and rose again to assure you of your salvation. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, praise to you and adoration. Grant that we your word may trust, confident of our salvation. While we here below must wander, till we sing your praises yonder.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you sent your Son to proclaim your kingdom and to teach with authority. Anoint us with the power of your Spirit, that we too may bring good news to the afflicted, bind up the brokenhearted, and proclaim liberty to the captive. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. Our Trinity kids will now sing their anthem. I invite the Trinity kids to come forward to sing. And now, kids, you can have a seat right there. You can sit. It's okay. And we're going to also invite the rest of the children to come forward because Pastor Duberstein has a special message for God, from God's Word just for you. So kids, come on up.
Well, good morning to all of you. Thanks for coming on up here. Let's see. Boy, there's a lot of you. I have something special to show you. Would that be okay? All right. Can you see it okay if I put it right here? All right. I have, this was given to me a long, long time ago, and I only pull it out for special occasions, okay? So let me open it up here. And here it is. This is a very special box, all right? This box can make things disappear, all right? So I'm going to need one of you. Let's say I need one, come on up. Come on over here. You're going to stand. So we have to make sure that, it's kind of about, you can see it, right? There's a drawer and everything. Here, let's bring it on over here because I need you guys to be able to see it too. Yep. All right. Can you guys see it? It's a drawer, and all it does is come out, right? So it's a drawer to the box. You see it? Yep. You see it? All right. Now, let's see if we can make something disappear because there are laboratories, and then they have to test it out first. And so they have to use like a mouse, right? So here it is. You take the mouse. All right, and we're going to put it in the box. All right, now shut the box. That's good. Now, what does a magician say usually? Make something. Okay, ready? On the count of three. Ready? One, two, three. All right, pull it out. Is it in there? Do you see it? It's gone. Do you see it? Yeah. All right. Now you're going to shut it again. All right. Now, say abracadabra.
Abracadabra.
All right, pull it out. There it is. That's pretty cool. How about this? All right, you can put the mouse away. And I wonder if we can make some other things disappear, okay? Can you hold up one at a time, hold up one of those so they can see the face? Now, you see, what kind of a face is that? It's an angry face. Are there times that you get angry? Who do you get angry at? Yeah. Oh, you mean the face, right? Oh, do you know her or something? Oh, really? Well, then we got to put, let's get rid of that anger. You put it in there, right? Okay, hold up the next one. What does that face look like? Sad face? Are there times you get sad? Let's put that one in there. So put it in the box. Good. What's the next face? Oh, hold that one up. Yep. What's that one? Crying. Put that one in because sometimes we do that too. And put up the next one. Yeah, question. We got a lot of questions and we don't know what the answers are. So let's get rid of those too. Good. And then what's the last one? Yes, embarrassed. Are there times that you get embarrassed and it seems like everyone's laughing at you and you don't like that, do you? So let's put all of those away, right? Okay, close up the box. Right there. No, we can't say abracadabra because now we're going to ask Jesus to take them away. So every time there's a part of a prayer that says, Lord, forgive us our sins, right? So on the count of three, we're going to say that. Lord, forgive us our sins. Ready? One, two, three.
Lord, forgive us our sins.
Let's see if it works. Come on over here. Pull out the drawer. Are they gone?
Yeah.
Is it gone? Is that cool? Is it gone? Do you know where it went?
No.
They are gone. Look behind you. What do you see? The cross. All of your sadness, And all the times we feel embarrassed and hurt, and the times that we do bad, it's not magic, but it goes to the cross and it's removed forever. That's not a magic in a box. That's the miracle of the cross. Okay? Thanks for coming up, guys, for today.
The first reading appointed for this third Sunday after the Epiphany is recorded for us in the Old Testament book of the prophet Isaiah, reading from chapter 61, beginning at verse 1. In our reading, Isaiah doesn't show us magic. Instead, he shows us a wake-up call and gives a wake-up call to God's people then and God's people today. And what he was doing is was giving hope that even though the people were going to endure exile and trouble, God said there would become a day when someone would rescue them from all of that. The Bible says this: "The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn and to provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. They will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew the ruined cities that have been devastated for generations. Strangers will shepherd your flocks. Foreigners will work your fields and vineyards. And you will be called priests of the Lord. You will be named ministers of our God. You will feed on the wealth of nations. And in their riches, you will boast." This is the word of the Lord. The second reading appointed for today is recorded for us in the New Testament book of Acts, reading from chapter 4, beginning at verse 23. We hear about how God continues his wake-up call to his people who speak with the authority of the Lord. On their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. Sovereign Lord, they said, "You made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouths of your servant, our father David. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kingdoms of the earth rise up, and the rulers band together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant, Jesus." After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. This is the word of the Lord.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia. The Spirit of the Lord is on me,
because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
The Holy Gospel for today is recorded for us in the Gospel of Luke chapter 4, beginning at verse 16. This will also serve as the basis for the sermon Pastor Duberstein will be sharing with us in just a few moments. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went to the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. He began by saying to them, "Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they asked. Jesus said to them, "Surely you will quote this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself.' And you will tell me, 'Do here in your hometown what we have heard that you did in Capernaum.' Truly, I tell you," he continued, "no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time, when the sky was shut for 3.5 years and there was a severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elisha was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy at the time of Elisha the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman, the Syrian." All the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up, drove him out of the town, and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built in order to throw him off the cliff. But he walked right through the crowd and went on his way. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you.
Please be seated. We continue our worship as we sing the hymn of the day.
As we come to you to receive the food of your holy word, take your truth, blend it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all your purposes for your glory. Teach us, Lord, follow me. reverence, holy reverence, true humility. Test our thoughts and our attitudes in the radiance of your purity. Cause our faith to rise, cause our eyes to see your majestic love and authority. Words of power that can never fail, let their truth prevail over unbelief. Speak, O Lord, and renew our minds. Help us grasp the heights of your plans for us. Truths unchanged from the dawn of time that will echo down through eternity. And by grace we'll stand on your promises, and by faith we'll walk as you walk with us. Speak, O Lord, as your church is built, and we fill the earth with your glory.
Bobby Bostick wakes up every morning at 4:45. He washes his face, brushes his teeth, and then he goes to breakfast 5:30. Then he comes back and he watches a little TV. He prays. Then he starts reading. After his meal times and outdoors times, he goes to bed at 10 p.m. every night. Then he wakes up, washes his face, brushes his teeth, eats breakfast. You see, Bobby Bostick is a prisoner in Jefferson City, Missouri. He grew up in a poor family in St. Louis, one of four siblings with all different dads. His father just wasn't around, and so with no male role models, he roamed the streets. By age 10, he started drinking and smoking. By age 13, he had moved on to illegal drugs and stolen cars. On December 1995, a 16-year-old Bobby and his friend committed 17 crimes in one night, including multiple armed robberies and assaults. He and his friend fired a gun at two different people. Thankfully, no one died. One of the bullets didn't even hit. Due to poor family counseling, he rejected a plea deal. It went to a jury trial. He was found guilty on all counts. And because of his perceived remorseless demeanor, the judge threw the book at him. 17 sentences for 17 crimes that was to be served not one on top of the other, stacked up concurrently, but consecutively, 241-year sentence. Unless the courts change it, he's going to be eligible for parole in the year 2091. Bobby is now 40 years old, which means he'll be 112 by then. And so Bobby Bostick is kind of stuck on repeat every day, every morning. This morning he woke up. And then he washed his face, brushed his teeth, and went to breakfast. I just want that to sink in for a moment. I want you to imagine you're standing in front of a judge. You did the crime. Your name is called. And then you hear the words 241 years. The judge says to you, you will die in prison. And from that moment on, your life is forever changed. It's gone. This is not a game. This is a wake-up call. Last year, in a BBC interview, Bobby said, I don't even know what I was doing. I can't make excuses. I wasn't trying to kill the dude or hit him. I can't make excuses for it. I shouldn't have done it, and I regret it. I'm not the same 16-year-old child that committed that crime. And it made me think, I wonder how many of us look back at our past like Bobby. That moment when reality sets in because the bottom of your world just dropped out. That part of your life that all of a sudden it just crumbles. Decisions that maybe you made that you wish you could take back, but you can't. Can you? A marriage, a relationship, your health, your kids. And when you look back and you look at those decisions, there's a part of you that wishes that you could reel back time. I bet you every person on the planet goes back to that moment. Words or actions, it's almost as if a moment in time is caught up and it replays itself over and over in your mind. And you wish you could go back and change everything about it just to make a fresh new start of it. You know what you would change, but now you can't. And then the horribleness just replays itself over and over again, like a 240-year sentence that you wake up to every single morning. But what if it could change? What if you could break free? Freed from the poorness of your past, from the prison of your guilt. What if you could hear something or see someone this morning who has the power to be able to change it all, and you never have to spend another night in a prison cell? In other words, you walk out of here today and it's a whole new reality. It's changed. I wonder if people with similar hearts full of regret and brains that were yearning and desiring for a do-over. I wonder if they're the ones that Luke had in mind in chapter 4. Jesus returned to Galilee, and he was filled with the Holy Spirit's power, and the people, they had heard of the miracles, they had heard his messages, and we're told that the people were just amazed by him. And then Jesus went back to his hometown in Galilee. In Nazareth. He even went and attended his home church, the local synagogue. And their service was very much like ours has been for today. There were prayers, there were songs. The rabbi would assign different readers for different portions of scripture, one from the book of Moses, another one from the prophets, just like we had this morning. And then the readers would get up and they would read, and that included even the one who was going to be preaching the sermon. See, he would stand up, he would read the word of God, and then the preacher would sit down and he would preach the sermon sitting down. So the listeners would be standing up and the preacher would be sitting down. I kind of like that. Jesus was asked to be the guest preacher, and so he got up and an attendant handed him a scroll. It was this big, long parchment, and on one end it was attached to a wooden stick. And then the other end, another wooden stick was attached to it. And so you could unroll it on one side and then roll it up on the other side. And so that's what Jesus did. He took this scroll and he unrolled it a little bit, and then he rolled it up here a little bit until he got to the very section of the Word of God that said this: "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And after he read it, he handed the scroll back to the attendants, and then he went and he sat back down. And Luke tells us, everybody's eyes were fastened on him. What's he going to say about these 700-year-old words? What's with this man who's going to proclaim some good news to poor people, who is going to free up prisoners and bring sight to the blind and give a way out to those who are downtrodden? And what Jesus says next has the potential and the power to change how you view your past and how you're going to leave here this morning. But if that's going to happen, you have to be Bobby Bostick, poor and a prisoner. And you have to know something about one day and one year. Here's the day. In ancient times, God would assemble all of his people together in one large group. He would take all of their sins, and then he would put them onto a goat, a scapegoat. He would transfer all of their sins onto that animal, and then he would send it away into exile, never to return. And so as that goat is heading that way, the people would be going in the other direction. As far as the east is from the west, God is removing your sins from you. It was God giving a picture of what he wanted to do for his people. It's called atonement, because atonement is what it's going to take to make things right. And so God is giving this beautiful picture of how he's going to help make things right between sinful people and a sinless God. And I'm not just talking about the small sins, as if God's forgiveness is only small. I'm talking about the big ones, like Bobby's. The big ones, like the ones that you seem to not be able to forget. God's forgiveness is big because God is big and powerful. See, there's no way that Bobby Bostick can live long enough to pay for his 241-year sentence. But that's not the point. The point is this: the punishment is life. I wonder sometimes if we don't realize my life of sin and your life of sin. God, it's not as if God pretends that it doesn't happen, or that he, the sins that you commit, it doesn't matter. God says, I must punish sin. And there is not enough years of your life that you can live in order to pay for it. It's just that God loves you so much that he said, I won't punish you. And so he took the threat and he carried it out on his son. And so his son, the death that you deserve for your sins, it was transferred onto the goat, a scapegoat of atonement, Jesus, exiled to the cross, so that when God says, I forgive you, it's only because the price is paid and the sacrifice is made. Day of Atonement, one day. But then there was this one year. God commanded his people, farm your land for 6 years, but on the seventh year, give it a rest. And then after seven cycles of 7 years, 49 years, then God gave another, the beautiful picture of what atonement was going to be. And there was this amazing event, and it would happen every 50 years. And this is what God declared: every debt is canceled. Think about that. All of your loans right now, gone. Every prisoner set free, a 241-year sentence, hereby commuted. And all of the land that had been sold in the previous 49 years would go back to the original owner, which means if your family had gone through economic hardship and you had to sell your land, you would get your property back. Tell me if that was the year of Jubilee, they called. A year of the Lord's favor. A year of total joy that conveyed the picture of the joy and the comfort and the freedom that is found in the God of all of forgiveness. So, when Jesus speaks these words, rolls up the scroll, and all their eyes are fastened on him as he's sitting down, these are the images and the pictures that the people have in their minds because they knew about this Day of Atonement. It came around once a year, just like Christmas. And some of them had even lived long enough. They had experienced that year of Jubilee, but now, instead of it being one of debt and prisoners, now it would be one of sin and salvation. Because God said, I must follow through on the threat, but now I've got a plan on how I'm going to deal with it all. And when Jesus sat down, he turned to the people and he said this. These scriptures, in other words, all of the incredible things that you just heard, it's been fulfilled in your hearing. It's a new day. It's a new year. And it's all because of one man. Jesus says, I am your man. I'm preaching the good news. I'm going to take all of your debts, all of your crimes, all of your past record of failings, and I'm going to give you my perfect record. I am going to comfort people. I'm going to heal the hurting. I'm going to guide the wanderer. I'm going to straighten up the person who's bent over with stress, and I'm going to make them into a sturdy oak. Tell me if you think that's a message that Bobby Bostick, with all of his past, needs to hear. Tell me, is that the message you need to hear? Jesus comes to a church full of people who know they have no value before God. Jesus comes into their midst and he says, this is the reason why I've come. I am not going to good people. I'm going to bad people. I'm going to poor people. People who are poor in spirit, because really, people who are poor in spirit, they're the only ones who are really going to get this message, because there's the middle class in spirit, and then there's the poor in spirit. The middle class in spirit, they come to church, they worship on autopilot, and they say, God, I'm here this morning, and this week was kind of good, okay, I wasn't perfect, but I've got some things in the spiritual and the moral bank. It's not as if I don't need anything, but I guess I do need a little help on the way. A poor in spirit person comes here today and says, Lord, I'm very guarded about what I want people to think and to see about me. And yet under my veneer, I've done bad. And sometimes the good things that I do, it's for bad motives. I try to control people. I try to make myself feel better. And sometimes, God, I even try to control you so that you do things for me. A poor in spirit person says, Lord, I've failed. I've got nothing in the tank. A poor in spirit person says, Lord, have mercy. I need grace. Give me a scapegoat. Give me some jubilee. And the God who realizes all your faults and failures and your sins, he then points to a cross where a sacrifice was made and atonement was given. And he said, it's full and free forgiveness. Bobby Bostick is forgiven for hurting people. You are forgiven for hurting people. And the God who has now just removed all of your sins and atoned for them, he says, now, as I have forgiven you, you can forgive. Because those who are forgiven, they forgive. Can you do that? Yes, you can. Because now you know the God who has atoned for your sin, and that's the God of all forgiveness. And all of a sudden, it's a new day. It's a new year. And the Day of Atonement is every day. And the year of Jubilee is 2019. And every remaining year of your life. And it's all because the man who rolls up the scroll and then sits down is proud to call himself your brother. Is this not significant news? And all of a sudden, even in eternity in heaven, isn't going to be long enough for you to thank and to praise God for everything that he has done for you. And yet tomorrow is going to be just long enough for you to share good news to the oppressed, to the poor in spirit, the one held captive by their guilt and by their past. This is news that changes everything. One day, one year, one man. May God give you that desire to be able to share good news, because tomorrow you get to wake up, wash your face, brush your teeth, and you're free. Amen. Please rise. The peace of God that goes beyond our understanding, may it always keep your hearts and minds in the freedom of Christ. Amen. Turn with me on page 13 as we join together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and from there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And please be seated.
Thank you, Pastor Duberstein. We just have a couple of quick announcements for you. First of all, we'd like to welcome all of you to our congregation this morning to worship God, especially the many visitors I see with us. We're very glad that you've joined us. And if you are a visitor to our church today, we ask that you just take a moment with our friendship books at the end of your row and just share with us some contact information so we can say thanks for coming and that you're always welcome back here. Just have three more quick announcements. First of all, I'm happy to tell you that our growth groups have launched this past week. Those are those fun, small group Bible studies that meet in member homes. They were described on that postcard that was sent to all of our member homes. This past week, even with the weather, we still had the groups go. Although on Wednesday, if you remember, we didn't have school here at Trinity, and I called the 20-somethings group to tell them, you know, maybe the weather isn't so good for you to have it, you should cancel it. And the leader said to me, no, Pastor, we have 18 people signed up, I really think we should. And we moved the class off-site just up the road at the Chancery, and eight people showed, including two non-members and two new members to our church. My point, neither rain nor sleet nor snow can stop God's word from being shared. If you'd still like to join up with a growth group, you still can, whether it's the one at the Chancery or another one. I'd simply sign up on the table in the back of church or just give our church office a call. We'll be glad to connect you. Also, this past week, we began our Bible information class. It was canceled. And so we're asking for your help. We're asking for your help and praying that God would give us good weather. This is Wednesday, minus degrees. We're not sure how that's going to turn out. However, I am happy to tell you that we're also offering the class on Sundays. And today we had six people show up. The point is, people do want to hear about God's word, and you can make a big difference in praying and inviting somebody that you care about. Please continue to help us do that. Finally, we have extended calls from our Trinity Lutheran School to fill our classrooms, and we just received a letter from Mr. David Porth from Pilgrim Lutheran School, and he gives us his decision. I'll just read part of it this morning. It says, "Dear members of Trinity, during the last month, I was given the exciting opportunity to learn about the ministry that is taking place at your church and school. After prayerful consideration, the Lord has led me to return the call to Trinity and remain at Pilgrim. I sincerely appreciated all the correspondence I shared with the leaders and members of your congregation. It's clearly evident that the Lord has blessed Trinity, and I firmly believe he will continue to do so." With that news, next week on Sunday at noon is our call meeting. We had planned to call one teacher. Look out that we may be calling two teachers. We pray God's blessings upon Mr. Porth and continued blessings to our Trinity Lutheran School as we continue to fill our classrooms. Those are the announcements. Now please take a moment with our friendship registers and as the ushers gather our gifts of love in the offering. Thank you. Good job, Samuel. Good job. Please stand for prayer. After we pray the prayer of the church, we continue our service with the Lord's Prayer. We pray. Son of God and light of the world, you revealed yourself as true God through your miracles and divine authority. As true man, dear Jesus, you preach good news to rescue us from our slavery of sin and certain destiny of hell. You came to calm the fearful, guide the wanderers, heal the hurting, and comfort the lonely and grieving. You took our place on the cross to completely pay our debt of sin. You were the scapegoat on the cross and earned salvation for us and every believer. Now continue to shine in our hearts with the light of your word, and let our lives always reflect your light before the eyes of those you place into our presence. Let us love others the way you love us, and may we bring your message of salvation to people who are lost and need your forgiveness. We ask that you bring your hand of healing upon Janet Herman, who had a full hip replacement surgery this past week. Thank you for protecting her life. And now, if it be according to your plan, graciously restore her. Give her patience and help in her time of need, and help her praise you for every good thing. We ask all of this in the name of Jesus, and together in his name we pray the prayer that he has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. O Lord God, our heavenly Father, pour out the Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us strong in your grace and truth. Protect and comfort us in all temptation, and bestow on us your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another. Serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace.
Amen. Amen.